are no longer general, and you are going to hand in your weapons now.
They would rape women. They would kill people. If, for example, somebody is passing through there and has nothing to give, they will, you know, treat you like, you know, an animal.
Are you going to maintain peace?
Yes.
Are you going to maintain peace?
Yes.
When we come to disarm you, are you going to hand in your weapons?
No.
Are you to me?
No. No.
Give it to you. We'll have it.
Are you going to give it to me?
Yes.
Are you going to give it to me?
Yes.
Well done.
We want no more war. We'll give it to you.
No more war.
No more war.
What are you talking about?
Take it out.
What are you talking about?
Take it out.
No more war.
Thank you.
Mama Buo.
Where go wa? Where go wa? Where go wa?
Mama Buo.
Where go wa? Where go wa? Where go wa?
Mama Buo.
Where go wa?
Where go wa?
Where go wa?
Mama Buo.
Where go wa?
Where go wa?
Where go wa? Where go wa? Where go wa? Where go wa?
Mama Buo.
Where go wa?
The war is over.
The war.
The war. The war. You know, like the it's finished. Yeah.
No more war.
No more war again.
He was a heartbeat away from becoming a full general and chief of general staff when he was controversially seconded to the UN and appointed UN force commander to rid Liberia of rebels. His exploits and successes remain a case of Kenya's, Africa's, and indeed the world's unsung hero. Was he a victim of military succession politics? This is KTN's Untold Story, General Opande, the unsung hero. Seventy-four-year-old Lieutenant General Daniel Ishmael Opande, now retired, has been and continues to be Kenya's, Africa's, and even the world's unsung hero.
Yes.
He is a three-star general who was appointed by the United Nations Security Council as force commander of the United Nations mission in Sierra Leone between 2000 and 2003, and later in Liberia, from 2003 to 2005, where he led a delicate, sensitive, and risky disarmament exercise against rebels, majority of them child soldiers of a country that had been ravaged by 14 years of civil war. A general who saw it all, but remains largely unappreciated.
I see you have very good AK-47s. These weapons are no longer to be shot to kill another Liberian.
A graduate from the British Army's Royal Military and the Staff College, General Daniel Opande was commissioned in 1964. He admits never imagined that he would be in a peacekeeping environment in any part of the world. Between 1990 and 1993, Lieutenant General Opande was sent to war-torn Liberia as a UN chief military observer to monitor rebels, the fighting factions, and the ICOMOG, a West African standby force.
Those who are fighters go that way.
He had initially served in Namibia and Mozambique. The largest rebel group in the Liberian conflict was under the command of Charles Taylor.
And I thought that would have been the last time I would be in peacekeeping. Again, neither did I know that a few years later, down the line, I would go back to Sierra Leone and command the largest ever peacekeeping force deployed by the UN anywhere in the world.
In 2000, then serving as vice chief of the general staff, deputizing then General Daudi Tonje, he was a heartbeat away from becoming a full general of Kenyan military, but Opande was appointed force commander of the United Nations mission in Sierra Leone. His appointment came at a time a platoon of Kenyan troops in the peacekeeping mission had been held hostage by the Fode Sanko-led Revolutionary United Front rebels, RUF. Of the 30 Kenyan troops, 4 had been killed. 26 were still in the hands of the rebels. Opande had firm instructions to secure their release immediately. He took over from an Indian general who had been relieved of his duties after force keepers, ostensibly Kenyan platoon, had been captured. He had his work cut out and had to move with speed. And he knew a lot was at stake.
So I went, stayed there for 2 weeks. In a shuttle diplomacy, you know, and, you know, from Charles Taylor in Liberia to Tejankaba, you know, President Tejankaba in Sierra Leone, and talking to the rebels in Sierra Leone.
However, there was a catch. The rebel commander Fode Sanko had been arrested and demanded his release before he could order that Kenyan troops be freed. General Opande had to change tact and hunt down his deputy, Issa Cisse.
As the force commander, the first thing I told my staff officers, get me Issa Cisse and arrange for a meeting between me and Issa Cisse as soon as possible. Within a week, it was organized, and I went to the bush to meet with Issa Cisse.
It is during engagement and altercation with the new rebel commander that Opande refused to leave the rebel territory until all Kenyan troops are released.
I told him, I want to know where the four Kenyan soldiers were buried. If you know it, tell me right now. He said, oh yes, I know where they are. They have been buried in various different places, in a place called Makeni and another place called somewhere else. And when you next visit, we'll take you to the places where they have been buried. Because I told him, we are not going to leave them here in Sierra Leone. We are going to take, these are our troops. We will take them home, we'll exhume their bodies, take them home, and bury them with full military honors back in Kenya. So that is the first thing we did. And that we did that.
From Freetown in Sierra Leone, the three-star general transitioned to Monrovia in neighboring Liberia in 2003 for his toughest military assignment ever. Then UN Secretary General Kofi Annan appointed him as UN Force Commander in Liberia. His duty was to lead a disarmament operation amid heavy fighting in the capital and the entire country.
There I am, landing in there with only one battalion of troops that I had commanded in Sierra Leone, and now coming with them to establish a new command.
This was a country that had been ravaged by 14 years of civil war. Everything was in shambles. The general says he remained silent for a few hours, wondering where to begin. The task ahead was enormous. So was the challenge.
It was quite a challenging task, and lots of challenges, humanitarian challenges, health situation, no food, no water, no electricity, nothing. So we had to deal with all that and stabilize. First of all, Monrovia, and then eventually stabilize the country as a whole.
General Daniel Opande took charge in Liberia at a time the United Nations clout was being questioned. To stamp the UN's authority, he was given 1 year to deploy troops throughout Liberia and disarm more than 40,000 fighters, mainly teenage boys who are not ready to surrender their guns.
Are you going to maintain peace?
Yes.
Are you going to maintain peace?
Yes.
When we come to disarm you, are you going to hand in your weapons?
No.
Are you to me?
No.
Give it to you, you won't have it.
Are you going to give it to me?
Yes.
Are you going to give it to me?
Yes.
Well done.
We
want no more war. We'll give it to you.
No more war.
The first mop-up exercise was in December 2003. Despite traversing the entire country, running the campaign Money for Guns, whereby rebels would be given cash in exchange for guns. It's only 12,000 who surrendered their weapons. He had to halt the drive and change strategy. It was during this period that he took a bold and risky step that caught his delegation by surprise. Annoyed by the poor outcome of the initial operation, Opande decided to take head-on a young rebel fighter, popularly known as Small General, who had defied his orders.
Young man, how are you? Who promoted you to one-star general? Who gave you one-star general? Charles Taylor or who?
Yes, sir.
Really?
Yes, sir.
Because you fought where? Where did you fight? To be given one-star general? You're not even worth, being a corporal. Not even being a corporal. Because I was with you here 2 weeks ago, right?
Yes, sir.
And I told you that I don't want, misbehavior on this road.
Yes, sir.
And then 2-3 days ago, you misbehaved again. You know, your people misbehaved again. Today, you have lost even your rank. You understand? You've lost your rank.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
You are no longer general, and you are going to hand in your weapons now. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Because I came here and I spent 1.5 hours with you. I talked to the whole lot of you, okay? And I told you don't harass people on this road. And you didn't listen, okay? I'm not here to fool around with you. You understand? I'm not here to fool around with, rebels. This is a public road. You understand?
It was an incident that left even his deputy commander, a one-star general from Nigeria, Brigadier Okonkwo, shaking as he wiped his sweat. Being in a rebel-infested territory and surrounded by heavily armed teenage rebels, they would easily have been shelled by the fighters. But a seemingly enraged and frustrated Opande says he had to draw a line with the rebels.
Maybe it was a little bit of frustration. Because only a week before, in fact, less than a week, I had gone and talked to the same little general with his commanders around him. And I told him, look, little general, the road from Monrovia all the way to Buchanan is now going to be opened for free movement of one-inch civilians without any, molestation, because they were really molesting, civilians. Every few kilometers, or even sometimes even yards, there is a roadblock. A roadblock which it was only meant to extort whatever they could extort from civilians. Poor civilians who have very little. And I had gone and talked to him, and that particular roadblock was really notorious. They would rape, women. They would kill people. If, for example, somebody is passing through there and has nothing to give, they will, treat you like, an animal. He had a weapon, and I took his weapon in front of his. I wanted that to act as an example to those who he commands, that there is a general here, a real general in this country, who is a no-nonsense general.
Surprisingly, unlike in his entire tour of duty, Opande never carried any weapon with him except his swagger stick. Even on that day he confronted the small general, he had no gun.
I knew that the action that I was taking, right, was the right action. But at the same time, I knew that those rebels there, unless one is, very bad in the head, would start shooting at me. I had a small contingent, personal protection, but as you have seen in the clip, I didn't carry no weapon.
His first disarmament operation had been scuttled by warlords who are running parallel rebel groups. In April 2004, he launched his second and final assault against the fighters to disarm them by all means necessary. This time round, he roped in an influential lady, Aisha Kone, wife to one of the warlords, who was well known to the fighters.
Aisha has handed you over to me, and it is me who is going to disarm you, and I will ensure that disarmament is done properly, and my troops here are going to renovate this school so that this school can be...
The second phase was yielding results. Across the country, the fighters handed in their weapon at specific locations on specific days in exchange for cash. Young boys who were not going to school, who had become child soldiers, were also handing in their guns.
No more war. You go to school, eh? Good, you go to school. Yes, I'm so happy to see you. The war is over, isn't it? Come, eh? The war is over. The war. The war. You know, like the do-do-do-do-do. It's finished. Yeah. No more war again.
When we return after the break.
Yes. We have been totally disarmed.
Yes.
But notwithstanding,
yes,
our arrears,
okay,
is in question. Part of Africa, we are looking up to you. Please do not be...
I won't forget it.
Thank you, sir.
In fact, I was told that, when I was...
We are the only...
Wait, listen.
Sir?